They're not going to go down easily. We have to go beat the game by the throat and win it.
Every single year, we talk about it. This is the year, this is the year, this is the year.
We are on a mission, and it's to win a WNBA championship. Anything else is a waste.
There is no game six. This is it. The decisive game five of the 2009 WNBA Finals presented by Adidas. A sellout crowd, standing room only crowd on hand here at US Airways Center. Better than 17,000 for Indiana and Phoenix tied up at two games apiece. Hi, everybody. Glad to have you with us from Phoenix. Terry Gannon along with Carolyn Peck. You have coached in games like this. You won a national championship at Purdue. You had that one game. What's your mindset if you're a coach? What are you telling your team?
Well, what you're doing is you're delivering a lot of reminders, but first, you're telling your team you are the best in your conference. You have worked all season long to put yourself in this position. Each individual player, you know your responsibilities. Now, there is no game six. You're going after a championship today, but most importantly, Terry, you need to have some fun.
And Katie Douglas and Lynn Dunn had a little fun earlier tonight. You think about the butterflies and whatnot. Watch as Katie Douglas comes off the kind of fist bump. Whoops, a little too hard. There go the glasses. And that'll lighten the mood a little bit. Katie Douglas, just an awful shooting night in game four at home. Maybe her worst as a professional basketball player. So new life for them and for Phoenix. This is it. Game five of the WNBA Finals. Dubois, Michael Price, Eric Bruton, the officiating crew, and it is Indiana controlling the opening tip. Tully Bevilacqua, guarded by Tamika Johnson, the veteran. Douglas out to Tamika Catchings, who has had three straight double-doubles.
The thing that looks for the Indiana Fever to do early is they've got to be ready to take the shot when it's there. They can't hesitate like they did in the fourth quarter of game four.
Bevilacqua the miss. And you heard Cindy and Nancy talking about that first quarter and how important it has been to Phoenix. Three straight games, the first three games of the series, they got down double digits. Last game off to a much better start. They shot 13 of 18 in the first quarter in game four, put up 33 points on the board. That's a record. Pondexter over Ebony Hoffman, Tangela Smith, a fresh 24. Cappy. Under control in the lane. And Phoenix is on the board first.
Cappy Pondexter has got to get involved early. First two games, she averaged only 2.5 field goal attempts in the first half.
Yeah, Cappy Pondexter matched up with Katie Douglas now as they swing it to Ebony Hoffman, who has shot 71% in the finals. That's close to a record, and that's a two-pointer. Turnover gives it back to Indiana. Lynn Dunn in her first finals. Indiana in its first finals. They have never won a WNBA championship. Phoenix looking for their second title in the last 3 years. Douglas around the screen, dumps it down. Tammy Sutton Brown off the glass and in. Nice little two-man game.
Points in the paint. That's what has been the strength of the Indiana Fever. That's why their field goal percentage was so high in the first three games instead of just settling on the outside jumper.
And they love to establish that early and then shoot the threes off of that. Catchings, the quick hands. Best in the league at that. Off to Douglas and the easy fast break points. Then Indiana, which has done a very good job in the open court. They won the fast break point battle in game four.
And they play some of their best basketball against the Phoenix Mercury. Their stats are better against Phoenix than any other team in the WNBA.
Johnson, the crossover. Up to Tangela Smith, best in the league at the three-pointers this year. That was a two and an air ball. Douglas on the run. Sutton Brown and the foul on Tangela Smith.
You gotta love Tamika Catchings, though. You watch this. She anticipates, gets the deflection. She comes down, saves it inbounds behind the back, and then she adds to the stat category with an assist to Katie Douglas.
Well, she's been huge since that first game. The game one loss here in Phoenix, that overtime game, which was one of the great games I've ever seen in the WNBA, let alone the finals. Catchings had 8 points and 6 rebounds, and she said, I've got to be much better than that the rest of the series, and she has been. She's been terrific.
Well, she was given the assignment to guard MVP Diana Taurasi, and a lot of times that can consume you. And she was only concerned about her defense, and Lynn Dunn had to remind her, hey, we have a few other things we need to do, need you to do while you're on the court.
Catching's guarding Taurasi now to open up as they switch on the perimeter. Nicole Willingham is swinging it to Johnson. Tamika can shoot that. 2 of 3 in game four. She's hit some big shots in this series.
I really believe, Terry, it's going to be the and others. For the Phoenix Mercury, you've got your big three. You've got Pondexter, Taurasi, and Taylor. But it's going to be what Tangela Smith and Tamika Johnson can add.
You go behind that screen, and she's going to make you pay. And that's exactly what happened. Got to fight through. Catching with the jumper, and here's Pondexter. The pull-up, Kepi. Sutton Brown beating everyone down the floor. Lynn Dunn told her team, look, the way we've beaten Phoenix, especially here in Phoenix, we've taken it right to them and run the basketball.
It's got to be a transition. Keep it up and down. Indiana has proven, like you talked about in game one, the highest scoring game in the finals. They've proven that they can run with the Phoenix Mercury.
Been quite a series so far. Combined, they're averaging 188 points per game, highest scoring finals ever. Tipped out with 19 on the shot clock. Corey Gaines trying to win his first title.
He comes straight to the ball.
He was an assistant for Paul Westhead on that championship team 2 years ago, which came back. They were down 2-1, remember, and that's what they're trying to do here. They were on the road and won in Detroit, the decisive game in 07. The only team to clinch on the road. Sutton Brown trailing. They won't guard her. Willingham finally gets a piece, but you can see the approach right now. They're not going to come out and try to guard Tammy Sutton Brown on the perimeter.
What? 3 points, yeah.
But Tamika Catchings, well, she saw she had Tamika Johnson on her down low. The post up, but the Phoenix Mercury are sagging off Sutton Brown at that free throw line area.
Yeah, a little talking down the court, though. Tamika wanted the basketball. Inside out they go. Back to Kepi Pondexter. And we'll have a jump ball. Seen that happen a couple times in this series. Pondexter, the fourth-year player from Rutgers. She was the MVP in 2007 in the finals when they beat Detroit.
And I really think Kepi Pondexter is the difference maker. When she wasn't involved in the offense in the first two games, it really was a struggle for the Phoenix Mercury. When she becomes an option, pushing in transition, and she doesn't need plays called for her, she can create her own shot.
Was that one of the biggest changes, I guess, the last couple of games, her being aggressive with the basketball and creating?
Most definitely. And Corey Gaines, he said it's his fault. He needed to get her involved early. Kepi was waiting for her number to be called, and once it was, she answered.
You saw that 23 points in game one for Pondexter, but most of those in the second half. Nothing wrong with that, but the first couple of games took her a while to get going early.
She's just capable of scoring without an offense. Coming in transition, pull up jumper, or take it all the way to the rack.
Douglas taking Pondexter, the one hand off the dribble, off the glass and in. Think she was too tight in game four, the pressure maybe a little bit much?
A lot of pressure. You know, that's why she came to Indianapolis, to win a championship. I think she puts a lot into that, the responsibility, thinking she's got to be carry the whole load. And she doesn't. And I think it'll be easier for her to play relaxed on the road.
Big rebound by Willingham, the offensive board, and Tully Bevilacqua picking up her first.
Well, after coming off a struggling night in game four from shooting, to establish her offensive game by going to the basket will definitely help Katie Douglas.
Penny Taylor on the floor. She was one of the heroes of the game one's win for Phoenix. 23 points in that game, 7 of 10 from the floor. 17 points in the last game. But she creates a lot of matchup problems for other teams.
And she's a big guard, so she can go inside and post up. And then she can knock down the three.
Willingham gets fouled. She'll go to the free throw line. And that foul on Katie Douglas. That's her first. So Indiana out to the 9-point lead. But Willingham trying to put a dent in that. Reminder, if you want to be part of the action, check out WNBA Finals Live on ESPN.com and WNBA.com. Players and ESPN analysts will be commenting on tonight's game, see what they're saying, and add your voice to the conversation at WNBA Finals Live. Phoenix, an 86% free throw shooting team. That's the best ever in the WNBA or in the NBA, by the way. Foul called on Phoenix. It's going to go against LaCole Willingham. That's her first.
She got called for the trip, Tamika Catchings.
Corey Gaines been very calm. It's been his approach through the series. Saying, look, it's coming along. Even when they were down in the series, so we're close. We're going to get there. No major changes.
He said he's a numbers guy, and he's playing the percentages, looking at the things that Indiana had done all year long and what his team's been able to do. He kept saying, it's coming. It's coming.
Douglas from Catchings. Taraji out there to change the shot. Willingham, another rebound. She's done a nice job on the glass so far. Hondexter, the up and under, right around Douglas.
That's what she can do so well. Attack the basket, split the defense, score the basket.
Taraji matched up with Catchings at this end. They're playing that rover, and now Diana's got to go all the way down. Quick hands on Hoffman. Offensive foul on Sutton Brown, setting the screen. Tammy Sutton Brown's first. We get the first break of the game. 4:32 left. A decisive game five in Phoenix. Indiana with the lead.
ESPN's presentation of the WNBA Finals is presented by Adidas. Impossible is nothing. And in part by IHOP. IHOP's gone NFL. Try the All-Pro lineup only at IHOP. Come hungry, leave happy.
Back in 2007, led by Penny Taylor's second 30-point game of the finals, the Mercury became the first WNBA team to win the title on the road. Paul Westhead leading them to that Game 5 victory, and Cappy Pondexter named MVP of the finals that year. Indiana trying to win the first professional basketball championship for Indianapolis since 1973, Carolyn Peck, when the Pacers won the ABA. And then, of course, Nat Region basketball king. Indiana won the title in 87. And Purdue, who was the coach that year? Remember?
I think that was Carolyn Peck. Yeah, Katie, that was me.
Katie Douglas, the star player, one of the star players that year. Last couple of games in Indianapolis, some scene with the sellout crowd, standing room only, the whole town really getting into the action and embracing the fever. The Pacers, by the way, are over in China. They've got a viewing party going on. Rip Simon, the owner, a part of that, and they're watching this game. They watched game four as well. And for the Phoenix Suns, they have changed their itinerary. They're going to Southern California to play a game tomorrow, and they've switched the travel so that they could watch the game as well. And that is Indianapolis at Conseco Fieldhouse, one of the great rooms inside. They've got up to 1,000 people in there. They brought them in. Season ticket holders, they're watching the game back there. Yeah, you guys are on camera now.
Well, Indiana, I mean, that's just basketball haven. When we made our run in 99, the whole state, Notre Dame fans, Indiana fans, they got behind a Purdue basketball team. Now you see the whole state get behind the Indiana Fever and the WNBA.
Here's the play that the officials were looking at. Whether this was, in fact, a three or not, Tamika Johnson early on put behind the line. So they do keep it as a three. 14-9, Indiana with the lead over Phoenix. 4.5 minutes left here in the first.
Well, both teams are trying to establish this first quarter has been a determining factor in this whole series.
Bevilacqua trying to stay with Taylor. Pretty good defense by Tully, giving up a lot of height. They'll try to take advantage of those switches whenever they can. Hoffman drives this time. Smith blocks it out of bounds. Indiana basketball. D'Angela Smith, third in the league for Corey Gaines this year in block shots. And first in three-point shooting.
I like what Ebony Hoffman is doing. She knows she has the respect of the Phoenix Mercury for the shot, and now she's putting the ball on the floor and going to the rim.
Sutton Brown along the baseline. Getting good numbers out of her there. They want a little better effort defensively from Tammy Sutton Brown.
Well, she's got to do a better job also on the boards. Only three rebounds in game four.
She's got seven in the game, points that is, right now. Pondexter swings it. Taylor, whistle first, 3 seconds. And Nicole Willingham in the lane too long.
Lynn Dunn, she's pleased with that defense.
You know her very well, and you've sensed her mood throughout. How about today for game five?
You know, she was really loose. And the thing about Lynn Dunn is she's realistic. You know, she just doesn't get freaked out about too much. Very calm. And she said, you know, you got to be a fever believer.
Lynn has a few sayings, you know.
That's an understatement.
Taurasi picking up her first foul on the reach.
You know, Terry, I'm really surprised you showed Diana Taurasi's numbers. In a game situation like this, this is when she really explodes.
Cross court to Taylor, picked up by Ketchy. So Douglas caught on Taurasi. Tough start for Diana.
She's not getting any open looks.
But that was an open look. I mean, for her, that's an open look.
I think Katie Douglas would be offended that you said that was an open
look. She didn't get the hand up. Taurasi fouled underneath after the rebound. Hard. I mean, if you're Diana Taurasi, you don't expect much of an open look that's better than that. You're challenged on most of them.
But Diana's going for the rebound. A little trip by Ebony Hoffman. You know, Diana Taurasi, though, you look at her numbers, scoring-wise, probably not Diana Taurasi numbers, but the impressive thing is that she's on the glass. And she's averaging about 7 rebounds a game.
35% from the floor, though, and that's not like the MVP at all.
Well, she's getting double-teamed and triple-teamed at times.
They leave Juana Bonner, who just came off the bench wide open, and she can't knock down the free-throw line jumper. Douglas, the penetration tipped out with 15 on the shot clock. If Indiana gets penetration like that throughout the night, they're going to be in this to the end.
They got to get the ball to the paint, whether it be off penetration or on the passing side to the post.
She doesn't need to be at the free throw line. You know, we're wasting time.
Rheon January has been a big part of this series. Maybe set to come in. Just 1 of 9 in game 4, though. Douglas, the spin. Looks for someone, finds Tamika Ketchum. Phoenix looking to run. They haven't been able to yet. Penny Taylor, the dump down. Tully Bevilacqua ties up Juana Bonner. So the shortest person on the floor underneath will create the jump ball.
She snuck in underneath Juana Bonner. Bonner didn't have any idea she was behind her. And then here comes that gnat, Tully Bevilacqua.
January loves it. She's on the sideline, about to check in now. Really one of the great rookies in the WNBA this year.
It's a great draft pick by Indiana to get Brianna January. And not just her offensive production, she's a tough defensive player as well.
You know, Tully gave it a shot there. She actually tried to get that jump ball. Pondexter draws the foul. Ebony Hoffman trying to stay with her. So that's Ebony's second. Here comes January, the rookie from Arizona State. Who in many ways is back at home.
Yep. Played not too far from here.
Jessica Moore, the fifth-year player from UConn, also in. So Ebony Hoffman takes the seat with those two fouls. You look up at the two-minute mark, and the Mercury only has 9 points in the first quarter. I mean, this has been a great defensive effort by the Fever.
Well, and their rotations have been very good.
Moore picks up the foul, trying to stay with Taurasi. Jessica's first. That was dangerous.
Back the other way. That's not good for our team.
Lynn Dunn's talking about force the other way. She wants the penetration to come baseline, not the middle of the floor.
Taurasi with the free throw. Reminder on TNT. Saturday, 9:30 Eastern time. Golden State taking on Phoenix, the outdoor game in Southern California. And from China, Denver and Indiana on NBA TV, 12 o'clock Eastern time. This is it for the WNBA, though, here in 2009. Game 5 of the finals, tied up 2 games apiece. Smith on the reach. Sutton Brown will go to the line.
Every time Indiana gets the ball inside, good things are happening. They're getting the basket or they're getting to the free throw line.
Fairly, don't you think they've been able to get it in there pretty easily so far?
And against a zone, usually you run a zone to keep the ball out of the paint, but it looks like Indiana becomes even more determined to go inside against this Rover defense.
Both teams with four fouls, so they shoot the rest of the way here in the quarter. Smith with the two fouls takes a seat. And Nicole Oldie, the 60-year player from Kansas State, comes off the bench. This crowd just starting to get into it. And it's a 6 o'clock local start with the traffic on a Friday afternoon, people working and whatnot, bit of a late arriving crowd, but they're here now. Taylor lets it fly. Remember, she had a couple of big games in the 2007 finals, going for 30. Big effort in game one this year. A whistle and a foul. They've got Oldie. And that's her first, so Indiana to the line.
Well, the Phoenix Mercury can get their offense going. It can come from Penny Taylor. You see this? She dribbles down. Katie Douglas has to step back. Penny Taylor positions her feet behind the three-point line and then knocks it down.
And the lip laceration, they call it. Caught an elbow in game two. Went to the locker room. Kind of a scary moment because we were getting reports for a good 25 minutes that they could not stop the bleeding, but it was a displaced tooth, and the tooth was bleeding, so she's been playing with a mouthpiece the rest of the series.
And the trainer, Tamar Poole, told us about how far the cut was inside her mouth. It's amazing. She's out here playing.
Had ankle surgery in the spring, didn't start playing until midway through the WNBA season this year. Contact. They'll call a walking violation on Penny Taylor. This was the injury back in game two, Carolyn.
Well, Breon January had a breakaway in transition. The elbow caught Penny Taylor right in the mouth, and then she recognizes there's something not right and immediately leaves the floor.
Tammy Sutton Brown lost it. Here's Tamika Johnson. Threw it right to Tamika Catchings. So under a minute to go. Sutton Brown, another bucket. She's carrying them right now. She's got the last 7 points and 9 of their last 11.
Tammy Sutton Brown is running the floor in transition.
Tarazi splits the double and gets Bonner alone underneath. Catchings, who did everything for them in game four. She was the one bright spot offensively. Moore, left-handed jumper. Sutton Brown fouled from behind. Penny Taylor picks up the foul, but Tammy Sutton Brown has come with a huge effort in the first quarter.
Well, she's doing the work on the glass. I think she's making up for lack of rebounding in game four. Offensive opportunities, offensive putbacks, and getting herself to the free throw line.
12 points already in the game. And make it 13. This is more than Indiana scored in the fourth quarter of game four.
You know, if Indiana can keep what they're doing up for the next three quarters, they're defending the three. They're not too many open three-point looks. And then they're getting the ball inside. They're really dominating the point in the paint. This momentum really favors the Indiana Fever right now.
Yeah, the pace of the game right now. And the Phoenix with very few opportunities out in the open court. Catchings to the bench. About a 4-second difference. Shot clock, game clock. Tipped away. Tamika Dixon, the veteran, comes off the bench and gets the loose ball. Under 10. January looking for a screen. Sutton Brown sets it. Breon backs up. Can't buy it. That'll do it here in the first. So the opening quarter goes to the visitors. The Indiana Fever behind Tammy Sutton Brown, tying a WNBA Finals record 14 points in the first quarter. Down to a decisive game five, and now underway here in the desert.
And when she's playing, nobody is safe.
We'll be right back.
Welcome back to a decisive Game 5 of the WNBA Finals. I'm joined now by Indiana head coach Lynn Dunn. Coach, another solid start offensively. How do you keep it going?
Well, I thought we really pushed the tempo early, but I thought we did some really good things defensively that led to some bad shots, and then we were able to turn them into transition layups for Tammy Sutton Brown.
What are those things that you did defensively to disrupt Phoenix?
Well, we're trapping Cappy more. We're trapping Diana more. We're trying to make their bigs make plays.
All right, Coach. Thank you. Terry.
Lynn Dunn, eager to talk on the sideline to Rebecca Lobo. She will be covering the Indiana Fever, and Heather Cox covering the Phoenix Mercury tonight. Heather, what do you have?
Well, Terry, a very focused and intense Phoenix huddle during the last timeout. Four-game stretch. The Fever are denying everything, so they must be sharp and crisp. Use sharp angles, stay aggressive, and be decisive. He added the Fever are getting to the line way too much due to lazy defense. They need to move their feet and stay wide, and always, he finished with, we must pick up the tempo. No fast break points so far for the Mercury.
Yeah, Heather, not a good sign. Only 16 points in the first quarter for the Mercury. That's the lowest output that we have seen in any quarter in this series. Taurasi finally gets the roll.
And it still wasn't an open look. If she went to the middle of the lane, she's still drawing two defenders.
First steal goal of the game for Diana Taurasi. Taylor staying with Douglas. Dixon in the lane. Tips up her own miss. Cleared by Taurasi. So you've got Taylor, Pondexter, and Taurasi all on the floor. The big three for Phoenix, and there is a big three from Diana. Corey Gaines going with his firepower to open up the second quarter. Jessica Davenport, good look from Douglas on that lob.
She has such a height advantage against the Phoenix Mercury, and especially the Rover defense inside.
Third-year player from Ohio State, twice the Big Ten Player of the Year. Pondexter, a fadeaway. That's a tough shot. January was right there.
She can create her shot anytime she wants to. She can elevate over the defense to score.
Davenport again. They find her all alone.
That's too easy. That's way too easy for the Indiana Fever.
Now, I know Corey Gaines will give up a deuce to get a three and turn up the tempo, but that was too easy. Speaking of easy, Taurasi making it look easy with a baseline drive. And the tempo has certainly picked up in the second quarter.
Well, and that's swinging the momentum in the Phoenix Mercury favor, especially with Taurasi scoring back-to-back baskets.
Moore, the handoff to Douglas. Scramble underneath, Dixon the rebound. And they'll use some shot clock now. Katie lets it fly from the same spot. Foot was on the line. That's a two-pointer.
She said she's got amnesia from game four. Not looking at what her shooting percentage is. She believes that every shot she takes is going in.
Can you have amnesia when you say you have amnesia? Oldie will go to the free throw line. First foul on Davenport.
Diana Taurasi only with 2 points in the first quarter. So she said, I'm due. First, she attacks off the dribble, gets into the paint. That'll get your rhythm going. And then you got to find Diana Taurasi in transition. She's going to knock down the three. She's feeling it now. She'll get this crowd into the ballgame with plays like that.
You know, watching her through the second half of the season and through most of the playoffs, I thought she was the most exciting player in the women's game I've seen in a long, long time, if not ever. And in this series, we haven't seen those spurts, those five-minute spurts where she just takes a game over.
Well, she has started in the second quarter doing that, yep. And I would look, as this game progresses, for her to pick it up.
High into the air for another rebound for Taurasi. Out to Pondexter. What a shot by Cappy. They got it going now. You need a stop or two at this end, though. Easy flash for Moore. Catching the rebound, and she is fouled. Johnson can't believe it.
You watch Diana Taurasi. She's going to rebound the basketball. And who's she looking for? Cappy Pondexter. That's amazing. The move to the basket.
Tamika Johnson to foul at this end. To the fast break points in favor
right
of the Fever. Sometimes that's misleading, though. You get a little secondary break that sometimes isn't counted. January and one. Brianna to the bucket hard.
She is a tough, tough rookie. Lynn Dunn's been tough on her all year, and it's paying off right now. This young lady's not afraid of nothing. She's going strong and determined to the basket.
Nicole Oldie picked up her second foul. So January at the free throw line, an 85% shooter. Lynn Dunn's been tough on her this year, huh? Lynn's been trying to motivate her throughout the year.
Oh, she has been on her, and a lot of times the veterans are having to console her or explain. Look, take the message, not how it's delivered.
Kathy's feeling it right now. 5 of 8 from the floor. She's in double figures. This has a similar pace now to the game one that went to overtime and was 120 to 116. Tipped away by Tarazi. Pondex, that doesn't have numbers. Kathy may go anyway.
It doesn't matter. She can score it anyway. She can create opportunities.
Trailer to Rozzi for three. Phoenix, a 2-point lead. Their first lead since it was 2-0. Davenport, just too much size. She's been a factor.
That'll silence the crowd. Everybody sat down on that two-pointer.
Willingham, the foul on Davenport. All of a sudden, it's a track meet. Nicole will be at the line when we come back.
Well, Diana Taurasi said, I'm going to keep this game exciting, knocking down the three, walking off, saying, oh, yeah. And then coming to Nicole Willingham, she's getting an opportunity for the 3-point play.
The WNBA cares about the community. For the third consecutive season, the WNBA and its teams partnered with the American Heart Association to raise awareness about heart disease and to encourage fans to take action to reduce their personal risk. As part of the WNBA's Go Red for Women Week, teams held in-arena Go Red Nights, participated in community events such as Heart Smart cooking lessons, and hosted WNBA Fit Clinics to show women and girls how to keep their hearts healthy and strong. WNBA, leading, inspiring, and creating positive change. Positive change for Phoenix here in the second quarter. They are perfect from the floor in the second. 8 for 8. Diana Taurasi is 4 of 4 here in the second quarter.
She scored 10 points with a quickness. To only have 2 in the first quarter, she came out full force firepower in the second quarter.
Interesting to watch this develop, though, because Corey Gaines has got his pace right now. It's going up and down. They had Taylor, Pondexter, Taurasi doing great things on offense. They can't stop anyone with size on defense.
Yeah, but Indiana only getting 2s, but you can't come down and give up 3-point shots to the Phoenix Mercury. The match just doesn't add up.
Tamika Catchings. Given that foul, that's her first, and Willingham the free throw, so it's a 3-point lead. Taylor fighting through the screens and over the top, now gets help. Great look to Hoffman. Newsflash, Ebony Hoffman finally missed a shot. Good pressure.
Tough defense, Ebony Hoffman on Penny Taylor.
Johnson, tough shot. Good defense by January. And here's Douglas. She'll bring it up under control. There's that inside game. Sutton Brown, we'll see how they whistle it. Walking violation inside.
But you see the Indiana Fever are continuing to go straight into the post. They have the size advantage down low.
Now, Lynn Dunn's team got the ball inside in game 4, but had a tough time connecting. Everybody had a tough time connecting in that game for Indiana.
Well, especially Katie Douglas from the perimeter.
On Dexter, that fadeaway with the leg kick. Kind of a patented jumper from Kathy, and she's red hot.
With the momentum she's got going, you may need to go. Michael Jordan rolls in double teaming before she even makes a move.
How did Catchings make that?
That was amazing.
It's kind of a throwaway, but geez.
Hey, it's for a world championship. You're going to see all kinds of things tonight.
Pondexter finally misses, and Ketchings with the rebound, making a living with double-doubles the last three games, and really has taken over. Waited 8 years and really had some heartbreaks. I mean, the injury, the Achilles, taking him out of the playoffs 2 years ago. Hadn't gotten a title yet, looking for a first to meet the Heat. Willingham slow to get up. Taylor doesn't use the screen, draws the foul on Sutton Brown, and the bucket. Danny Myers, the general manager here in Phoenix, loved it.
One knew we were going to see something special tonight. With Cappy Pondexter, who makes plays like that, that's incredible. And then Penny Taylor attacking, driving to the basket.
Sutton Brown, her second. Pondexter, Tarazi, and Taylor again on the floor. But Tawana Bonner set to check in. And this is a team that averaged 93 points per game during the regular season. Again this year, they set the record for points.
They're looking for as many possessions as possible. As soon as there's a rebound, turnover, and even after made baskets, they're running in transition.
That call ball, Paul Westhead, that Corey Gaines learned at Loyola Marymount. Nice dish. January, setting up Sutton Brown underneath. She's carried the load offensively. 16 in the game for her.
And look for the Mercury to continue to use ball screen situations and attack.
Willingham taken away by Ketchum. And the foul on Pondexter. It can't be a bit shaken up after committing the foul. She'll go to the bench.
The Ketchum's as she came down after she released the layup, caught Cappy Pondexter right across the face.
So Cappy's still up on the floor, but they're going to sub for her, and Ketchings misses the free throw. Pondexter with 12 points already in the game, 6 of 10. So she and Tarazi terrific here in the second quarter. Is there a better all-around player, though, in the league than Tamika Ketchings?
She plays hard on both ends, offensively and defensively. And it's not just her scoring offensively. She distributes the basketball as well. And then she's a terrific rebounder.
That pretty much covers it.
Don't know what else you could want from her.
Tarazi's got another three, set up by Penny Taylor. Those are the good looks that Lynn Dunn absolutely does not want Diana Tarazi to get.
Well, it's the open threes, the ability to catch and shoot, not having to put the ball on the floor, that drives Lynn Dunn crazy.
Sutton Brown guarded by Diana. Out to Ketchings. As she sets the screen, Taylor couldn't get through. Tamika, 3 of 5, and 8 points in the game.
See, that's a good double team to make Diana Taurasi give the ball up. One-on-one, she can make things happen.
Bonner goes to the free throw line after the bucket. Third foul on Sutton Brown.
Diana Taurasi is going after a championship. If there's the MVP in the league on the floor, you got to know exactly where she is.
Cindy Brunson inside the WNBA studios. Coming up at the halftime report presented by IHOP, we will break down the first half. You'll find out why Hall of Famer Nancy Lieberman keeps beating the desk and why she's cheering about a team in the Bronx. That's right, we're updating baseball playoff action for you as well. All that and so much more coming up at the half. Terry, Carolyn, back to you.
Cindy, thank you. No Yankees fans here, I don't think.
I don't think so. Right? No.
Yeah, and my White Sox are not in it, so it doesn't matter. Phoenix up by 6. Cappy Pondexter, though, went to the locker room. They're working on here. See the late injury on the break. That arm of Ketchings coming down and catching her in the face. Cappy said she was all right, but the doctor said, nope, we got to go back to the locker room and check it out. Heather, do you have more on that?
Yeah, Terry, Cappy definitely wanted to come back in, but once the doctors looked at her, they decided to take her back to the medical area by the locker room. One team physician was with her. They have now called in another one who is an eye specialist. He is now looking at her. I'll let you know as soon as I know more.
All right, thanks, Heather. And obviously, they can't afford to lose Kathy Pondexter.
Well, no, she has been the force, especially scoring in transition. That means that Tamika Johnson will have to run the one. The one thing that Phoenix could do is bring in a Nicole Oldie or LaCole Willingham and move Diana Taurasi at the one.
Yeah.
Then you have Penny Taylor on the perimeter.
Bonner with the block. 13 left on the shot clock. That foul, by the way, before we went to break, now given to Ebony Hoffman. So she has three. Sutton Brown still has two. Great timing.
Well, Phoenix Mercury is trying to find an answer for the height of the Indiana Fever inside. Bonner made her presence felt.
Screen and roll. They'll call the offensive foul. And now Sutton Brown does have three fouls.
What kind of call?
So Lynn Dunn takes a full timeout and not at all happy about the call. Take a look, see.
And Sutton Brown sets the screen and then she rolls.
Well, the only thing you could say is she maybe extended the arm, and that's what the official saw from behind. There wasn't a great amount of contact, was there?
I didn't see a lot of contact. A lot of times there's a foul called on that screen and roll if the defense goes behind and you use your body to shield off. But she screened and then rolled into an open area.
They won't leave her. Turn it down, straight to the basket. All right? If the one happens to come, you'll be open, Lee. Okay. But you're going to get to the basket and have it.
Hey, make sure we get to this so she jumps on
here. Great point.
So both coaches talking offense right now with 2 minutes and 20 seconds left until halftime. Lynn Dunn wanting to be more efficient on the offensive end and still attack inside. And Corey Gaines, most of the time, talking offense.
All the time talking offense. But Indiana wants to score early, and Lynn Dunn was frustrated that the team wasn't getting into it set earlier. People getting into the right positions, especially the post players.
Still no Campy Pondexter, who's gone to the locker room with that injury. So Taylor looks to take Douglas. Off the glass and in goes Penny Taylor, and it's a 9-point Phoenix lead. Catchings setting up Douglas behind the screen from Davenport. Tipped out, starts the Phoenix break. One and done for the Fever.
The extra effort's coming from the Phoenix Mercury right now. They're getting all the loose balls.
Here's that matchup. Catchings and Taurasi. Johnson. Tamika Cleary. Catchings. Juana Bonner, they're playing. Bonner with the bucket, and you got a player down at the other end. That whole possession
Tangela
for
Smith.
Phoenix, it's Tangela Smith, yeah. So they played 5-on-4 at this end.
That's, get an open
yeah,
shot.
That's not a good sign.
No, not a good sign.
So Tangela Smith down right in front of the Phoenix bench. And they'll take a 20.
Am I going to lose a fool right now? Am I going to lose a fool? Am I going to lose it?
No.
Am I going to lose a fool anyway? Am I going to lose a fool anyway?
Yeah, but if we take a 20.
I'll take a 20.
All right, so they're trying to sort out whether or not to take the full right before halftime, or whether he's going to lose it, and it will be a full timeout.
And so Tangela Smith never made it down.
And she's hurt. Do I get as long as I want? And she's hurt?
Well, yeah, but you're already taking a pull now. You can carry your 20,
you can't carry your 20. You can't carry your 20.
It's all what you want to do.
I know, but that's why I was asking. That's why I said I wanted the 20, because I could take as long time as I want.
Well, I gave you 20.
But then I asked you a question because I wanted to make sure.
All right, watch what happened on the last offensive possession with Tangela Smith.
He comes in and gets caught right in the tummy by an elbow. Right in, she ran into Jessica Davenport's elbow.
And Davenport, 6'5", 215 pounds. But Heather tells us over on that sideline that Tangela Smith is now fine. So,
we're in the ball.
Listen to him.
Free
TV?
Yes. And listen up. 1 minute. You got to go hard for 1 minute. Now, if we get the stop, I want a drag. I want drag. If not, I want C3 again. But this time, I want you to come straight ahead and set it right there. Take your time. Come right in, right up the middle. You're in the corner. He's there. No, take this out. Take this out. I want you to stay here first and then get out to that corner. So she's going to stay here, then she's going to get out. You stay there, me.
Okay.
All right? Yes. You go to the corner. You're out.
All right, you saw the numbers a moment ago, and it was the three-point shooting. I know they're trying to establish the inside game Indiana is, but they're struggling beyond the arc. And there's Kathy Pondexter walking back by the locker room. So we'll get more on her. Heather will definitely check out that situation. Tangela Smith is fine right now for the last minute 10. But how about this in the second quarter? Phoenix 13 of 16 from the floor.
Wow. That's, and they're getting everything they want. You know, they're penetrating in, getting to the basket, because what Phoenix is doing is they're spreading the floor. When you have Tangela Smith on the floor, Diana Taurasi, Penny Taylor, you're penetrating in. Defense can't help in. They've got to make a decision. Do I stop the layup or do I stop the three-point shot?
And it really hasn't slowed down since Kathy Pondexter went to the locker room.
A lot of times teams, when they, one of their top players is out, then it's the other players that step their game up.
Davenport, they've gone to her a number of times inside. She wanted the foul as well, but the easy bucket, there's nothing Taurasi can do there.
And that's so easy. I don't understand why Indiana doesn't do that more often.
Jessica with 8 in the game. Johnson can't pick it up. Bonner, again, left all alone. Gives it the extra leg kick with both. Catching.
Davenport needs to get down low. She's got Tamika Johnson on her.
It's Moore to the left hand. Tough shot over Bonner. Douglas going to let it fly with no shot clock. They get the offensive rebound anyway, and now they want to take the last one. They had a chance to do that a moment ago.
You got Jessica Davenport that's on, has Diana Taurasi defending her. It's a huge size mismatch.
Now the switch out front. Taurasi runs right into the screen of Davenport. January can't buy the bucket. Diana saying, hey, where's the foul here at this end? The stare as she heads to the locker room. And Davenport asking for the same thing. 35-19. Phoenix outscoring Indiana in the second quarter. Rebecca?
To make a Phoenix 13 of 16 that second quarter, how do you overcome this 9-point deficit?
Well, I mean, we got to come back out. We got to come back out with fire. We didn't do a good enough job. I think Diana got a lot of you looks, Cappy, you know, Penny, all of them. And we just have to pick it up defensively.
All right, Tamika, thank you. Heather?
Joined by Diana Taurasi. Diana, when Cappy went out into the locker room with an injury, mentally, how were you able to take over?
You know, we just had to be aggressive. And, you know, when we get stopped and we push it, we get really good things. So, you know, it's just kind of the game plan right now.
Diana, we'll let you get to the locker room. Thank you.
All right, Heather, thank you very much. The IHOP Halftime Report coming up in just a moment. First half analysis and Major League Baseball playoffs update. So a great second quarter for the Mercury here in Game 5, 51-42. Phoenix with the lead as they play for the title. Tamika Catchings, 8 points in the first half, looking for her first championship. Diana Taurasi, 15th for Phoenix, looking for her second.
Welcome to the IHOP Halftime Report.
WNBA Defensive Player of the Year, Tamika Catchings, with 8 points. Her Fever has some work to do, down 9 at the break, and deciding game 5 of these WNBA finals. And with that, we welcome you inside the WNBA studios. I'm Cindy Brunson. This is the Hall of Famer Nancy Lieberman, and this is the IHOP Halftime Report. Tale of two different first quarters in that first half. The first 10 minutes dominated by Indiana, the second 10 minutes by Phoenix. What was the difference for the Mercury in quarter number 2?
Cindy, I thought in the first quarter, it was really unusual, but Indiana came out loose and relaxed and ready to play basketball. It was the Mercury that came out really tight. They were throwing the ball all over the gym. They had 6 turnovers. They didn't know what to do with Sutton Brown. Second quarter, oh my gosh, were they loose and looked like they were playing street ball when they were kids. They just looked like they were getting up and down the floor and actually enjoying the moment.
All right, well, part of that enthusiasm on the offensive side of the floor came from Cappy Pondexter. Now, before the eye injury, 6 of 10 shooting, 12 points. But if she's unable to go in half number 2, how do the Mercury compensate for her offense?
Well, it's not easy when you have Cappy Pondexter on the sidelines, because she's the one who's the X factor. She can take you off the dribble. She can shoot the 3. She really has a lot of dimensions to her game. I believe she will be back into this basketball game, but it puts more emphasis on Penny Taylor, on DeWanna Bonner, on certainly Diana Taurasi getting the ball and hitting some of her shots. But to me, the Mercury did a great job of taking away the inside, which hurt them in the first quarter.
And Diana did step up in quarter number 2, 13 of her 15 points coming in the second quarter. Of course, offensive explosion, can't talk about that without talking about the Yankees in the Bronx. ALDS game number 2, Twins and Yankees knotted up at 3 runs apiece. We're in the bottom of the 10th. The captain, Derek Jeter's at the dish with Brett Gardner on second base. We are tied because Alex Rodriguez came through with a game-tying home run in the bottom of the 9th. A-Rod 2-for-4. He has driven in 3. His Yankees, who the person to my left supports mightily, trying to take a 2-games-to-none series in this American League Division Series. How about the other ALDS series out west? LAA would also like to take a commanding 2-games-to-none series lead over Boston. We're scoreless in the bottom of the 2nd inning. It is Josh Beckett and Weaver battling so far. So good as far as the pitchers are concerned. Boston 9-2 in ALDS competition against the Halos, still looking to get on the board in this series. Diana Taurasi putting her team on her back, as we've seen her do so many times this season and in these finals. She's got 15. What she needs to do at half 2 is next.
You're watching the IHOP Halftime Report.
Now, welcome back to the IHOP Halftime Report. Penny Taylor with 8 points. Her Mercury with a 9-point lead at the break, looking to lock down their second WNBA title in 3 years. For more, we turn to the Hall of Famer, Nancy Lieberman. Nancy, both you and I were kind of questioning Tammy Sutton Brown's ability to hit a bunny coming into game 5, and she opens up with 14 in the first quarter.
She does have a little bit of a problem finishing around the basket, but this is a big, strong woman. If she could really be an asset to the Fever if she would make those shots around the basket like she did in the first quarter, where she had 14 points, went to the foul line 8 times, because you can see the Mercury now have to take the ball out of the net. She's quick enough to run the floor. And I just think with her presence on the floor, like I said, when you're that big, you're that strong, you have to take advantage of that situation, because you not only get the Mercury in foul trouble, but then you're making foul shots and it slows the game down. And that could be a decided advantage in tempo for the Fever.
Sutton Brown with 14 in that first quarter, just 2 in quarter number 2. And in that second quarter, Diana Taurasi woke up and smelled the coffee. 13 points. What was the difference for her?
Well, she started getting shots in the flow of the game. Instead of her trying to create shots or shoot on the run where maybe she's leaning or a little bit off balance, I thought she started to read the defense a little bit better. Here she was looking for that mid-range game where she was pushing the ball out. That's transition. Nobody found her. She's on that little bit of a drag. Again, you're too late, Dixon, recovering out to Diana Taurasi. She's 6 foot. She's stepping into her shot in rotation.
So this is where we stand. Phoenix up 51-42 at the break. We've got 20 minutes before we crown a champion. The series all locked up at twos. You were saying how good Phoenix was from three in this game. What's the difference for the Mercury from behind the arc?
Well, the difference is that you might think that you can play with the Mercury. It's almost like a little bit of an illusion. You continue to shoot baskets and match them. But when the Mercury are shooting threes, it's almost, I said this in game one, is fool's gold, because they're getting 3 points and you're getting 2 points. So you're seeing the baskets being matched, but you're not seeing the point total being matched. And that's where all of a sudden you're down 2, 3, 4. And now at the half, it's 9 points.
All right, I want you to put on that coaching hat, grab that clipboard. You're Lynn Dunn. What are you telling your Fever at the break?
I still think that she has to continue to trap Taurasi, Gabby Pondexter, and Penny Taylor. But I think it's the second line rotation that has to come earlier. It's help the helper and take away the middle part of the court where Lacole Willingham is getting the basketball. They have to push up on her and make them throw the skip pass all the way to the corner, because you can recover on the flight of the ball and still stay in your half court defense.
In the other locker room, it's Corey Gaines. May not have Gabby Pondexter in half number two. What adjustments do the Mercury need to make?
Well, they made the adjustments to me in the second quarter. They stopped throwing the basketball around the gym. You know Indiana's going to jump all the screens. They're going to get out in the passing lanes. You fake a pass to make a pass. That means you get a player who's attacking. You get them to lunge, and then you can either go backdoor. That'll soften you up a couple times as a player if you get beat backdoor.
All right, I'm going to give you one last chance to change your mind. Still going with Phoenix?
I'm going to take the Mercury.
All right, she likes the Mercury. I love working with her. She's the Hall of Famer, Nancy Lieberman. I'm Cindy Brunson. Thanks so much for being with us for this IHOP Halftime Report. We are all about emotions in these WNBA Finals. Up to this juncture, everybody's laid it all on the line. We expect more of that in the final 20 minutes. Enjoy the second half.
One half of basketball left for the WNBA title as we welcome you back to the 2009 WNBA Finals presented by Adidas. The Edge going to the home team, the team that won it back in 2007. Phoenix with a 51-42 lead over the Indiana Fever. Terry Gannon back with Carolyn Peck. The Mercury red hot in the second quarter, Carolyn. They shot over 76% from the floor. How does Indiana counter now?
Well, I think they need to get back to what they were doing in the first quarter, and that was attacking the basket. They were able to penetrate in, and when help came over, distribute the basketball. And then they went inside to the post players as well. Jessica Davenport gave them good buckets inside. But it was the second quarter for the Phoenix Mercury, and the stars showed up. Kathy, Diana, Pina Taylor, they showed up big in that second quarter and gave the Phoenix Mercury their lead.
The superstars catching with just 8 points, doing a little bit of everything once again, though. 4 rebounds and a couple of steals. Taurasi big in that second quarter with 15 points. Gabby Pondexter injured in that second quarter. Heather Cox, what do you know about her?
Well, Terry, I was able to talk to the eye specialist that evaluated Gabby Pondexter during halftime after she took that blow to the eye in the second quarter. He performed a full eye exam. He ruled out a scratched cornea and any other abnormalities. He also checked her vision. Pondexter passed all the tests and is able to return to action. Good news for Phoenix fans. 6 of 10, 12 points before the injury. Now let's check in on Indiana with Rebecca Lobo.
Heather, I talked to Ebony Hoffman, and she said Indiana needs to pick it up defensively. They gave up too many transition points, especially to Diana Taurasi. And then she said, we have to stop the dribble drive, even if that means taking somebody's head off. And offensively, she said, the three-pointer, we got to continue to take the open shot. We've got great shooters, and we are going to start hitting them here in the second half. Terry.
Well, Rebecca, this is the first game that we've seen Ebony Hoffman struggle a bit. She's got 3 fouls, only 2 points. She's been averaging almost 20 points per game.
Well, you've got to believe that the Phoenix Mercury are playing extra attention to Ebony Hoffman because of what she did in the first 4 ball games.
Hoffman with 3 fouls. Tammy Sutton Brown also with 3 fouls. No one in foul trouble for the Phoenix Mercury as we open up the second half of play. Pondexter on the floor to start it. They swing it to Tamika Johnson. Line drive jumper over the backboard, and it goes back to Indiana. Look at that number in the second quarter, 76.5%. Lynn Dunn, though, in the locker room, you heard her saying, we can win this game.
Well, if they tighten up their defense on the three-point shot and then play to their strength. They have a size advantage inside mismatch. Sutton Brown has Dinah Taurasi nailed down low in the paint.
And they're going to call the foul on Taurasi. That's the second on Diana. So you get a look at what Lynn Dunn wants to do offensively through most of this second half with this first possession here.
And they can create opportunities to score, but the main thing Indiana has got to be concerned with is defending the Phoenix Mercury.
Tipped Hoffman down the lane. That's what we've gotten used to in the finals. Ebony Hoffman doing a little on the outside and a lot on the inside.
But the spacing is the correction that the Phoenix Mercury made in game four. You see, you've got 5 players out on the perimeter, so it gives them opportunities for their superstars to create, just like Dinah Taurasi did right there.
Hot shooting continues for Taurasi. She was perfect, 5 for 5 and 3 for 3 beyond the arc in that second quarter.
With Tamika Johnson guarding Tamika Ketchum, she can give the ball up and then go down low and post up.
Hoffman challenged by Pondexter. Good job by Caffey coming out to change it. Tipped away by Catchings from behind. Taurasi never saw her. You go by someone, where's the only place they can be?
Behind you.
There you go. And that's where Catchings was.
Well, Taurasi never sees her. And there's a reason that Tamika Catchings is defensive player of the year. And it's because of plays like that. She takes advantage of every opportunity defensively that she has.
Matched up now, Tamika Catchings is with Pondexter, not Taurasi. They swing it. Caffey can't quite handle it. 6 on the shot clock. The pull-up. Long 3 for Pondexter. Double-digit lead.
Now you got Catchings, and now Taurasi has the defensive assignment of guarding Tamika Catchings.
Strips it away as she falls down. Taurasi finally up. Smith. Nope, Sutton Brown with the rebound. Bevilacqua. Out to Douglas, who had the stutter step. Wasn't quite set, had no rhythm.
She hesitated, and then she locked her feet. The shooting coach, Marvin Harvey, is here and talked about stepping into your shot, not just locking both feet down. It's hard for a shooter to get into a rhythm.
Quick hands again of Catchings, takes it away. Well, you got to know where she is at all times. Douglas around a screen, had Sutton Brown, now finds her. Good look from Katie Douglas as no one stayed back to guard the bucket.
The two-man game for the Indiana Fever can work. Guard the post on one side of the floor. There's no help there.
See if Pondexter takes Bevilacqua. Not this time.
If you look at all 5 Phoenix Mercury players are around the perimeter. That leaves open lanes for penetration.
Right down the lane, taken away by guess who? Catchings ahead of the pack. Douglas, the block by Taurasi. Second block of the game for Diana Taurasi.
Katie Douglas cannot believe there was no foul called. Taurasi trailed it, timed it, swatted it out of bounds.
Taylor, a cheerleader for the moment, now checks in.
Oh,
actions around the screen. Boy, you talk about why great players, stars, bring it in the big games. You're looking at it right now. From Taurasi, from Pondexter, from Catchings. A little something extra. Willingham, he's got Sutton Brown one-on-one and gets the roll. Drawn bucket from the code.
If you're going to give up anything to the Phoenix Mercury, it's Lacole Willingham. You don't want their scoring to come from Diana Taurasi, Kenny Taylor, or Cappy Pondexter.
Sixth-year player from Auburn. Douglas. And the foul on Pondexter. Second foul on Cappy. And Katie Douglas, an 86% free throw shooter. And Douglas, who is from Indianapolis, after a couple of finals with Connecticut, wanted to go back home. Played in high school, less than 10 miles from Conseco Fieldhouse, trying to win a title here. Reminder, Saturday afternoon, ABC delivers regional college football action. You'll see either Wisconsin taking on number 9 Ohio State, Baylor against number 19 Oklahoma, or Oregon and UCLA. Connecticut and Pittsburgh also part of that lineup. 3:30 Eastern, 12:30 Pacific on ABC. 5-point game.
Indiana has been able to close the gap with their defense.
Catching's a little bit late, a little bit too much body. Whistle for the foul. Second foul on Tamika.
And Penny Taylor, she's going to get involved in the act. And the thing that she can do so well from the guard position, because of her strength and her size, is attack the basket.
And defensively, you got to give up something. And you're looking at trying to slow down Pondexter, slow down Taurasi, and then all of a sudden Taylor comes on the floor, and she can be just as dangerous.
Well, the three stars for the Phoenix Mercury are able to shoot the three, and then they're good off the dribble. So, I mean, you got to mix up how you guard them, and a lot of times it requires a double team.
Bench points the edge to the Mercury, which hasn't been the case in the last couple of games.
Sutton Brown changed the shot. Tangela Smith there. Not so easy in the paint.
Willingham, the bounce pass to the corner. Smith, another try. Lacole gets it out to Pondexter. They leave it open at the free throw line. Standing room only crowd here in Phoenix, loving it right now.
The second chance opportunities Phoenix is creating for themselves.
Silencer, Douglas the three. Good sign for Lynn Dunn if she can get it going. Hasn't yet. Kavalakwa underneath. And they'll keep it here with 17 on the shot clock. So Taurasi still red hot from the floor. Cappy Pondexter doing great work. And right now, it's a 62-56 lead for the Mercury. Of the WNBA Finals. Some possible MVPs. Ebony Hoffman's had a great series. So too for Tamika Catchings. And if Phoenix wins this game, Cappy Pondexter and Diana Taurasi, certainly two of those that you would look to for an MVP. Might take a breakout second half here to get an MVP though.
I think it will be the performance of the second half that will determine who is the MVP, because all of these players have had their moments throughout this whole entire series.
Pretty hard to split them right now, right? Often a bit of a struggle in this game, just 4 points right now, but averaging almost 20 a game. You get the sense, Carolyn, that Lynn Dunn's team is doing much more of what they want to do here in the second half so far?
Well, I think they have adjusted when Phoenix Mercury have spread the floor. They're saying you have to defend your person one-on-one off penetration, because we can't help off three-point shooters. And then creating offense from their defense with Tamika catching steal opportunities. They've been able to cut and creep down and cut the lead to 6.
A little work being done there in the corner. It's been a great series on a number of fronts. Certainly attendance-wise. great crowds, two capacity crowds, games three and four back in Indianapolis. Another one here in Phoenix. Over 17,000 on hand. Taylor trying to post up Douglas. They can't get it to her. Both players stay with Tarazi. She still beats him. Tough shot, though, and Hoffman the rebound. Tarazi started the game 0 for 3, and she was a perfect 6 for 6 since until that miss.
The Mercury in their Rover defense now. You see, Tarazi has to come all the way out to guard Ebony Hoffman.
And they miss Sutton Brown, who is wide open underneath. A little up-the-court pressure from the Fever. Belacqua looking for a call. Sees Pondexter go right by her to the left hand and in. Forget about begging for the call. Got to guard Cappy.
You have to guard. You cannot let her get past you in the paint. Keep her out in front.
19 in the game for Pondexter. There's the post up. Sutton Brown missed an easy one, gets it back, and now a chance for three.
Happy Pondexter just goes right by Tully Bubalakwa, and Sutton Brown's worried about blocking the shot. But she gets the basket back, points back, and an opportunity for a three-point play at the free throw line.
Angela Smith picked up her third. Sutton Brown, the numbers. Loose ball foul. It's going to go on Ebony Hoffman, and that's four on her. So Hoffman picks up her fourth. Stays on the floor, though.
Well, they need her on the floor because she is such a good defender. She's just going to have to move her feet and try to defend without fouling.
Juwanna Bonner, who has not been a huge factor in this series. She was throughout the regular season, the sixth woman of the year in the league, but the last couple of games played 9 minutes and 8 minutes. That's it.
Well, it's a big scoring for the Phoenix Mercury right now.
3 seconds! 3 seconds in the lane. Got some help from the fans courtside on that call. He picked it up, too. Second, 3 second violation we've seen tonight. Hoffman picks up number five and better be careful. Close to picking up a technical as well. But Carolyn, you've got almost 3 minutes left in the third quarter and Hoffman's got five fouls.
You have to keep your emotions in check. A lot of unnecessary contact with Juwanna Bonner. She's going to go set a screen. You know that's where she's going. Just beat her to the spot.
So Hoffman takes a seat, and it's Christina Wirth, the rookie from Vanderbilt, who's played a total of 24 seconds in this series, coming on to replace her. Bonner, the fadeaway. What a pretty-looking jumper, huh?
When she gets going, she is something special.
Bevilacqua sets the feet, gets the rotation, and buys the three. Set up by Catchings. But Wirth, who has just come on for Hoffman, was sick. Wasn't even there in game four. And now has to play a major role in the second half of this decisive game five.
What that does bring to the Indiana Fever is Christina Wirth is a very good three-point shooter. So it's the opportunity to spread the floor and then go inside, get yourself to the paint. Wow, no call on Tamika Catchings there.
Yeah, she can't believe it as Tangela Smith reaches in, and they'll just give it to the Fever out of bounds. Yeah, it may have been some contact there.
I think so.
Yeah, I think. Eight on the shot clock. Nicole Oldie off the bench now for Tangela Smith. Got to get it in. 5 second violation. Nowhere to go with it.
She's
So Lynn arguing the fact that the ball wasn't placed in the hands of Tamika Catchings.
This is going to be a close battle, back and forth.
Taurasi, what a quick trigger. And Catchings escapes it somehow. Things going against Indiana right now with the fouls and Hoffman and Worth having to go play significant minutes, but it's still a 7-point game. Taurasi on the run. Bonner made it a tough shot. Three chances for Phoenix, and now the foul on Indiana.
Rebounds are going to make the difference. Second chance opportunities. The Phoenix Mercury are getting chance after chance with the putbacks.
Second foul on Tully Bevilacqua. Reminder for game breakdowns, press conferences, highlights, and interviews, WNBA.com and NBA TV are the places to turn for full post-game coverage of the WNBA Finals. 8-point game with the free throw from Taylor. Indiana with 14 fouls. So Phoenix will shoot the remaining minute 22. Mercury with 3 team fouls. Taylor the 2 free throws and the lead up to 9 as Taurasi takes a seat.
Now the Phoenix has gone with Jessica Davenport. More of the size inside to battle with Nicole Oldie.
Blocking foul on Taylor. And she can't believe it. Second foul on Penny. Was she there?
I don't believe she was set. I think she was still moving toward the baseline.
I don't know. It looked like Catchings initiated that contact.
I think she impeded the progress.
Extended the elbow.
Impeded the progress.
We'll go back and forth.
I don't believe she was there. That's like taste great, Les Philly.
Not going to sway me. Catchings got the first one. And Corey Gaines now up off his bench. One of two, Oldie clears it.
Got to make your free throws when you get those kind of opportunities, especially when you're playing for a championship.
Pondexter, who told you she'll try to bait that double team around that screen out top and hesitate. Oldie with the miss, worth the rebound.
Yeah, she told me at shoot around when I said she was hesitant with the trap coming or indecisive. She said, no, I was just baiting the defense to come after me and then decide who I wanted to pick, take off the dribble.
January the 3 set up by Katie Douglas. Rhian January has been a huge factor in this series. And it's a 5-point lead. So for all the scrambles for Indiana and seemingly losing control for a couple of minutes and Hoffman going to the bench, it's a 5-point lead.
Well, it looked like the Phoenix Mercury were going to get on a roll and extend it, but Indiana continues to find ways to chip away and get back into the ball game.
Floater halfway down and out for Johnson. Worth gets it out to January in under 10 now. They'll take the last shot. Rhian January behind a big screen from Davenport. She's got Johnson on her back. That won't count. Late getting it off. And so that'll do it here in the third. A 7-2 run for Lynn Dunn's squad to close out the third quarter. Indiana outscoring Phoenix 23-19 in this quarter. We head to the fourth. One quarter left to play for the title. And the Mercury with a 5-point lead.
Welcome back to Game 5 of the WNBA Finals. Phoenix with a 5-point lead, joined by head coach Corey Gaines. Coach, you're 10 minutes away from a WNBA title. How do you coach this team not to look ahead?
I tell them right now to win this quarter. All I do is tell them to win this quarter. That's the first stage.
Ultimately, in your mind, what is going to be that one thing, that one differentiator that'll be the difference?
Getting a couple of stops, but getting, make sure we get the rebounds when they do miss. Don't give them second chance points and to push it on the break.
Coach Gaines, thank you.
All right, Heather, thank you. Right now, it's been very even on the boards. 25-24, Phoenix with the edge there. But you hear that, in his mind at least, not letting Tamika Catchings and the bigs inside get a second chance here in the fourth quarter.
You know, it's surprising, as much as Corey Gaines is an offensive coach, his whole discussion with Heather was about defense.
Well, you come down to championships in the end, one quarter left, and it does become defense and rebounding. Here we go.
I think it's also, Terry, going to come down to making free throws. Indiana has missed six, and they're only down five.
It was an awful fourth quarter for Indiana in game four that cost them that game. Davenport from Douglas. They find her underneath. No way to match that size for Phoenix.
Yeah, the only point really close to her height is Nicole Oldie, and she's not in the game right now.
Trying to deny Taylor the basketball. She has it now. Davenport tipped away. Run down with five on the shot clock. Johnson making something happen. Out of bounds and a fresh 24 for Phoenix. So Davenport getting significant minutes. And Ebony Hoffman, remember, on the bench with five fouls.
And Indiana has made the adjustment of covering on the perimeter.
Taylor stripped by Catchings.
I think Catchings got away with one there.
Great players do every now and then, you know.
Every now and then.
Worth the traveling violation, gets it back to the Mercury. So it's a three-point game with under nine. Pondexter coming back to get the basketball. Reminder on TNT Saturday, the autotrader.com open NBA outdoor game with Golden State, Phoenix, and then from China Sunday on NBA TV. Denver and Indiana, end of the month, the regular season starts in the NBA. Off of Worth, out of bounds, 12 on the shot clock for Diana Taurasi.
Did you watch every time Taurasi, Taylor, Pondexter get the basketball, the Indiana Fever are bringing an early double team.
Taurasi shoots it before they can double, and that's the way to beat a double team, I guess, huh?
That's the best way to beat it right there.
Gets it off so quickly, not much you can do to defend that. Davenport with Taurasi on her back. There is the double. Quick hands. Catchings gets it back. Under five on the shot clock. January lets it fly. Difficult shot at the end of that possession. Here's Taurasi, who's 4 of 6 behind the arc.
Look how far the Phoenix Mercury have the defense extended. The Fever are all just about outside or near the three-point line.
Willingham can't handle it. Good look from Taurasi. The bump along the baseline by Tangela Smith, and that is 4 on Smith. First team foul. He's the only one that is in any kind of foul trouble for Phoenix.
Look for the Indiana Fever now going in the paint or penetrating opportunities so they can get to the free throw line.
Davenport, pretty left-handed shot on the turnaround off the glass. They love it back in Conseco Fieldhouse. They've gathered there to watch this one after selling out the last two there. The bump. And Worth trying to defend Diana Taurasi. Second foul, it's January who gets that foul. So under 8 minutes to go, and you would expect to see the major players step up and try to take control right now, and you've seen it from Taurasi.
Well, Taurasi's going to handle the ball a lot. She's either going to be taking the shots or creating in because she's going to attract so much attention.
Overall MVP this season and won the scoring title as well. Trying to get the triple with an NBA WNBA championship as well.
Davenport's got the size advantage. Go to her inside.
Now they switch. Worth saves it. Douglas. Tipped out, but only 3 seconds on the shot clock. They look a bit lost right now on offense.
And because they look lost, Lynn Dunn's calling the timeout.
Yeah, no real rhythm offensively. With Ebony Hoffman out with those five fouls, you cover Douglas, you cover catching, somebody else got to step up. So Lynn Dunn will talk things over. Under 7 minutes to go here in a decisive Game 5 for Phoenix.
ESPN's presentation of the WNBA Finals is presented by Adidas. Impossible is nothing. And in part by IHOP. IHOP's gone NFL. Try the All-Pro lineup only at IHOP. Come hungry, leave happy.
Chase for the NASCAR Sprint Cup heads west. Last week, Tony Stewart reemerged as a championship contender following his win in Kansas. Can Mark Martin or Jimmy Johnson answer back? The chase for the NASCAR Sprint Cup with the Pepsi 500 at California Sunday at 2:30 Eastern on ABC. What they're playing for, championship trophy. They're preparing that backstage. Will it be Phoenix for the second time in 3 years or Indiana for the first time ever? Big three playing big for Phoenix tonight. Diana Taurasi is at 7 of her last 9. Kathy Pondexter, 7 of her last 10.
Well, you had to believe that Diana Taurasi was going to step up huge. And right now, with 22 points, she's playing like she does when she's playing for championships.
All three played large roles back in 07 when they won the title. Turnover gives it back to the Mercury. And here's Pondexter controlling. Lynn Dunn starting to worry just a bit.
Now, she's keeping Ebony Hoffman on the bench. She's got five fouls, but you're playing for a championship right now. Put her in the game.
You'd bring her back, right? Offensively, they've really struggled in the last few possessions. Taylor tips it out. It'll be Fever basketball. Tammy Sutton Brown set to check in as Hoffman continues to sit.
Yeah, with Hoffman having the ability, or at least the threat from the perimeter, would open up even more things for Jessica Davenport inside.
Worth can shoot that and does. That's a 2. The foot was on the line, but you mentioned her ability from the outside.
Well, she is a great three-point shooter at Vanderbilt University. So maybe that's why Lynn Dunn has her in the game, with Ebony Hoffman being cold tonight.
A lot of confidence to place on her, having hardly played in the series. Pondexter, after they got a shot back from Smith, Happy knocks down another 3. They've had an answer every time there's been an Indiana run tonight.
And when the Phoenix Mercury have missed shots, it's the second chance opportunities, and not the 2-point putback, but the 3.
Taurasi, the foul as Douglas goes hard. 3 on Diana.
Kathy Pondexter makes this look like a layup. When Tangela Smith finds her, kicks out for the 3, she strikes a pose and knocks it down. She said, ooh, that's pretty.
Some MVP votes may be being placed for Pondexter with 22 in the game. 11 tonight for Douglas. And the first free throw. Remember, Katie in game 1 really carried the load in the second half. She had 30 points in that overtime loss and hit the big 3 to send it to overtime. And then they came back and won game 2, which is, you know, one of the reasons Lynn Dunn came in here confident, saying to her squad, look, we know we can win here. We've won here twice this year. Taken away by Ketchings. In fact, in the 6 meetings between the 2 teams, regular season playoffs this year, the road team won 4 of 6.
That gives the Indiana Fever a lot of confidence coming in here tonight.
Angela Smith, the foul, and that's 5 on her. As Davenport will go to the free throw line. Total combined points now over 900, and that is now officially. It makes this the highest scoring finals ever.
And we still have 5 minutes left to play.
That record was not in doubt. They were going to pass it. 188 points combined on the average.
to the fourth quarter in this series has been exciting, except for game four. It's been changes of leads. There's not been one clear team that has extended out and kind of put a team away. It's gone back and forth. So I think we're going to be in for a treat the last 5.5 minutes.
No, it's been a terrific series. Entertaining basketball, too. I mean, it hasn't been, you haven't had one quarter where it's really been ugly basketball. Davenport the foul. Fieber can't believe it.
You got to believe you're going to see Dinah Rossi make more plays like this down the stretch. That's tough.
Rossi won 3 national titles at UConn, won a WNBA championship. And that's what you're going to see from her the last 5 minutes and 20 seconds. Hoffman still sits.
Corey Gaines has got to continue to put the ball in her hands or plays run to her. She is a big-time player that really shows her best stuff on this stage.
It's that intangible, too, isn't it? I mean, that killer instinct from her that not many have. She's got 7 of the 10 points in this quarter for Phoenix. Sutton Brown now guarded by Chalazzi. Swing it to January. She can shoot that and does. 3-pointer from Breon January, the rookie, and it is a 2-point cave. Here we go. January getting to play in a WNBA Finals in her rookie season. You got people like Catchings who've waited their entire career. Tamika trying to stay with Taraji. Tough shot off balance. And a chance for the Fever at the 4.5 minute mark here to tie it or take the lead with a 3.
It's going to come down to rebounding, the second chance opportunities.
And we are tied at 80. They go nuts back in Indianapolis. Sutton Brown, the bucket. She's had a big game. Pondexter loses it. Smith, pump fake. Sutton Brown goes flying by. Tangela Smith just takes her time and says, this is what I do best. Hit threes. First bucket of the game for Smith. There's the post up. Replay of a couple of possessions ago. Davenport making it look easy.
And she's pivoting to the right and then shooting a bank shot with the left hand.
Yeah. 16 in the game. Smith, can she hit another one? Oh, yeah, she can. 2 in a row for Tangela Smith.
The adjustment Corey Gaines made from 3 to 4 was spacing for Tangela Smith. Since she was inching in the first 3 games of the series, she spaced out and is knocking down the threes.
Pondexter clears it. They'll look to run, and Willingham up there, and Taylor will give it back to Cappy. Look out. Taraji misses a wide open 3. Jessica Davenport letting it fly. She's feeling it right now. A scramble underneath, and they're going to call the foul, I believe, on Taraji. And they will. That's 4 on Diana Taraji. So we get a break in the action. 2:45 left here in Game 5 for the WNBA title. 2 in a row for Tangela Smith. Back here in Phoenix, they haven't been quiet through this entire timeout. Phoenix looking for their second title, Indiana their first. It's a 4-point lead for the Mercury with 2:45 left. Terry Gannon back with Carolyn Peck. You just kind of knew that neither team was going to run away in this one. It was going to be a tight one down the stretch.
Well, you know that because of what we've seen. And what Phoenix needs to do is they've got to continue to penetrate in and get the layup. And the advantage they have is they have 3-point shooters that are hitting their shots.
What Indiana needs to do is they need to continue to feed the post. They're getting their three-point plays. A lot of them are coming from their post players. So if they can move the ball quickly and get it inside, that can be Indiana's threes to trade for those from Phoenix.
6 of 16 tonight for the Fever, and much better for the Mercury in terms of the threes. But the officials huddled as we went to break and decided they were going to call a double foul on Catchings and Taurasi. Look at the numbers on Diana tonight, 24 in the game, and much better beyond the arc. She had struggled coming in the finals. She was just 24% throughout the series.
Well, just waiting for Diana Taurasi to explode, and she has thus far in the ball game. She's a big-time player. She knows what it takes to win not just a championship, but the second and third championship.
So Catchings has three fouls. Taurasi now with four fouls, and they'll jump it up at center court. Tamika Catchings, been one of the great players in this league throughout her career. An eighth-year player from Tennessee, won a national championship there with Pat Summit. She's hearing impaired. She's dealt with that since she was a child, wears hearing aids, and has had injuries, an Achilles tear taken out of the playoffs a couple of years ago. Finally, a chance for her to win a WNBA title. She's trying to do it here on the road. And the reach on January as she tries to stay with Pondexter. Whoa. The official catching three on there.
You're going to see both teams look to create off penetration and get themselves opportunities at the free throw line.
Three fouls on January. Both teams with three fouls in this quarter. So the remaining 2.5 minutes here, the decisive game five. Series tied up, two games apiece. Kathy Pondexter has been terrific tonight. Pondexter with 24 in the game.
She can create at will anytime she wants.
Great look down low to Davenport, and that's what's worked for Indiana. That size advantage of Jessica Davenport off the bench has been a major factor.
Well, she's huge, and I mean that literally. She is arms and shoulders taller than most of the Phoenix Mercury players.
Pondexter, can she hit it again? No. Cleared by Catchings, looking to run. Catchings with 8 rebounds in the game. January, this is where those shots get tough to take, let alone make. Sutton Brown cleared by Smith. That's a big rebound with 1.5 minutes left. Do you use some clock here?
Yeah, and that's exactly what Kathy's doing. Use the shot clock because she has shown it can get down in the late clock and she can score the basket.
Under 10 on the shot clock, big possession. Pondexter gets just a little bit of room. No, here comes January. Douglas. Katie over to Taurasi. Way off. Catchings the offensive rebound and the putback. It's a 2-point game.
Again, Phoenix is going to use the clock. But you see, he's got Defensive Player of the Year on Kathy Pondexter right now. Knowing she's going to be the one that's going to try to do the creating.
Shot clock down to 5. Taylor's got to go. Looking to create, and the foul. Penny Taylor, a 90% free throw shooter, will go to the line.
Well, even though Katie Douglas is not able to knock down the shot, Tamika Catchings comes in, gets the rebound, and puts it back in. And then Penny Taylor tries to take Breon January off the dribble. Jessica Davenport and Tammy Sutton Brown clobber as she tries to go to the basket.
So that's the fourth team foul on Indiana. Phoenix to shoot the rest of the way. Taylor makes the free throw. And it's a 3-point game. Phoenix with a foul to give.
Still don't understand why Indiana doesn't put Ebony Hoffman back in the ballgame. She's a 3-point threat at from the post position.
Good point. Full timeout taken by Lynn Dunn, but it is a 2-possession game now with 37.7 left.
And there's enough time right now. But Indiana needs to come down, score the easy two, and then think about their foul situation.
Call for panic. Okay, guys, here's what we're doing. And be ready. We're rolling line to double on ball. All right, now. Bree, you're coming out and going out over here. So Bree, you'll be here. Katie's coming here. We're going to get her the ball here. All right, Davenport, this is you. This is Christina. She's coming right into here. Bree, you're here. Okay, you're rolling. Christina, you're popping back. So we're looking for the shot here, the drive and the kick over here. All right? Whatever we get, whatever we get. We need a quick score, whatever we get. No fouls again, no fouls again.
Check the clock. If we get a quick score, we might not need a foul. Check the clock.
Guys, if we score quick, like right now, if it was like 29 seconds, we don't have to foul, okay? But if we don't score, we have to foul.
All right, so you heard Lynn Dunn say if they can get a quick one, they won't have to foul and they can play out that shot clock defensively. But they do not have a foul to give. They've got two 20-second timeouts, and Phoenix with a full and a couple of 20s and a foul to give.
3 points, yeah. Yeah, on offense.
Get a shot, defense. 1, 2, 3, defense.
3 points, get. You dribble to the side, keep your dribble. Watch him coming up.
So they're hoping here inside U.S. Airways Center that they are 37.7 away from their second WNBA title. Tamika Catchings has other ideas. But you've now got Breon January, Katie Douglas, Worth, Davenport, and Catchings. You've got some offense on the floor for Indiana.
And Lynn Dunn subbing Christina Worth instead of Ebony Hoffman. So now she's got 4 3-point shooters on the floor, and then have Davenport go inside down low.
Douglas looking for a screen. Back to Worth. They play the high-low, inside out. Catchings to Davenport, in and out. Tipped out of bounds. It'll stay at this end, but the shot clock is off. You've got 21.4 left.
I can't believe Davenport passed it back out. Score that quick two.
Yeah, Lynn Dunn calls another timeout. So this will be a 20. You got to remember what she said in that huddle, too. She hopes to get a quick shot. They didn't get it.
Got to score quick. All right, we're running two. We're running two. Teddy's going to come out here. Bree, you'll be popping back here. If we don't get the shot here, then look right here. Then Catch is going to come out either side for the shot. You big.
Got a foul.
Now we have to foul. We got to score and foul.
.4 left here in game five. Don't forget, SportsCenter comes your way next. Diana Taurasi looking for her second title. Lynn Dunn and Tamika Catchings trying to get there for the first time, and you got to make up some ground here with just over 21 seconds left and down by four, looking for the quick shot and then the foul.
Well, they've got to score it and immediately find someone to foul to stop the clock.
Douglas off. January gives him another try. Katie Douglas again. The rebound to Bonner, and there's the foul with 12.2 left.
January hustles for the play, and then Douglas has another look, but she's not able to knock that shot down.
First look was a tough one with defenders right in her face. The second one is one that Katie Douglas would like to get back. Bonner with the free throw. DeWanna, an 81% free throw shooter, and the lead is five. Here comes Hoffman, Worth back on for Indiana. Mercury with a big edge at the free throw line tonight, Carolyn.
Yeah, a lot of people question, could DeWanna Bonner play in this league? And she's been a huge contributor, sixth woman of the year, coming off the bench for the WNBA.
6-point lead, another timeout taken by Lynn Dunn. So Indiana's out of timeouts. out of most options, it's a two-possession game. You've got some three-point shooters still out there, and if, you know, that's what Corey Gaines is telling his team right now. Look, this one's not over yet.
Well, they cannot relax, but I believe this is pretty much in the hands of the Phoenix Mercury. They've made back-to-back tough defensive stops. When you've got leaders on your team like Pepe Pondexter, Diana Taurasi, those are two women who won a championship in 07, then didn't even get in the playoffs in 08. They can taste championship right now.
Catches the inbound to Hoffman, who has sat much of this second half. Jumper, that's a two. Taurasi, the rebound. And the foul called. Taurasi will go to the free throw line. They're on their feet here in Phoenix. Corey Gaines, part of his second WNBA title, perhaps. Remember, he was an assistant for Paul Westhead 2 years ago when they beat Detroit on the road to close it out.
And he kept that same up-tempo, fast-paced transition basketball.
Two for two. The lead is eight. Final possession. That'll do it for the second time in 3 years. The Phoenix Mercury on a champ to the WNBA. Break for Katie Douglas, Tammy Sutton Brown, Tamika Catchings, and the city of Indianapolis. The celebration has begun here in Phoenix.
It's the experience of the Phoenix Mercury and the killer instinct that you have in a player like Diana Taurasi. Very frustrating not getting to the playoffs last year. It's got to be very rewarding to get a championship now in 2009.
How about that duo right there? Taurasi, 26 points, 6 rebounds, 4 assists. Pondexter, 24 points, 4 rebounds, and a couple of assists. And they just would not let this team lose tonight.
They willed them, and I knew when her back was against the wall, Diana Taurasi was going to be huge. And that's exactly what she was tonight, making big shots, making big plays, knocking down her free throws.
Penny Taylor, who joined the club mid-season after the injury early. She had ankle surgery in the spring and now part of her second WNBA championship team.
She's a big reason coming back after the All-Star break that put the Phoenix Mercury in this position.
You know, back in 2007, they were down 2-1. They had to go on the road and win it. They were down 2-1 in this series, had to win game 4, an elimination game. And that made them 4-0 in those games throughout the playoffs. I mean, that big reason why you're looking at it right there. Taurasi, who had the most points in this game tonight, than she had in the entire series in any of the other games. Kathy Pondexter, also a star tonight. Standing by right now with Rebecca Lobo.
Kathy, another hard-fought game and a hard-fought series. What did it take to get this championship win?
A lot of hard work, togetherness, and camaraderie. We wanted it really bad. We came out a little slow, but we picked it up in the second, third, and fourth. You can tell this team really, really wanted to win.
Your second championship in 3 years. What is it like to win it here in Phoenix?
You know what? First, I got to thank God, because without him, it wouldn't be possible. And for the city of Phoenix, it's all for you guys. They're dedicated. They've been with us from the beginning. And I just want to say, we love you.
It's also good to thank Diana Taurasi. What has it been like to be on the floor with her in this series?
I love Diana. You know, not as a basketball player, but as a person and as a friend. And I couldn't imagine winning without anybody else without her. I love her.
All right, Kathy, thank you. Terry.
Rebecca, thanks. And, you know, Kathy Pondexter told you that she had to take a moment in game 4 at Indiana just to say a prayer and calm down, because it was so wild and so loud in that place.
She said when when the Indiana team came on the floor, the whole place felt like it was shaking, and she did. She said, I had to pray and calm myself down, but she didn't have to be too calm in here. When this Phoenix Mercury crowd got behind this team and exciting, it was electric. I almost had to pray and calm myself down.
Nice to hear players admit things like that, though. You know,
it is.
Today, Tamika Catchings telling Rebecca Lobo that, yeah, I got butterflies. Believe me, this is as big as it gets, and I'm nervous.
Well, I asked Kathy Pondexter if she talked, and Dinah Taurasi talked in Russia about winning this championship, and she said, oh, yeah, we talked about it all the time.
You're looking at a couple of winners right there. I mean, on every level. And nobody leaving yet. They're staying for the ceremony, which is about to begin here inside U.S. Airways Center. You got a feel for not only Lynn Dunn and the fever, but all the folks back in Indianapolis. They really embraced the fever the last couple of weeks. All right, ceremony about to begin as we join the PA announcer, Kip Held, right now.
And the WNBA Finals MVP Award presented by Adidas. Please welcome ESPN's Heather Cox.
And congratulations to your Phoenix Mercury, the 2009 WNBA champions. For the second time in franchise history, the Mercury capture the title. And now for the WNBA Finals Championship presentation. I'd like to introduce Robert Sarver, General Managing Partner, Annie Myers Drysdale, GM, as well as Corey Gaines, head coach. And now for the trophy presentation, please welcome WNBA President Donna Orender.
Wow, was that not the most spectacular WNBA final series presented by Adidas we've ever seen? It was spectacular. And heads off to the Indiana Fever. What a great organization. I truly believe that Indiana helped the country capture, get WNBA Fever. So thanks to Herb Simon, Jim Morris, Rick Fusen, Kelly Kraskoff, and of course Lynn Dunn and her entire team. And now, the Mercury has indeed proved mighty once again. Robert Sarver, Annie Myers-Drysdale, Jay Perry, Rick Welts. For the second time in 3 years. Second time in 3 years. Where's Annie? It is indeed a pleasure. Let me also call out Todd Davis and LifeLock. We are proud to present the 2009 WNBA Championship Final Trophy to the Phoenix Mercury.
Robert, congratulations. You know what this feels like. In 2007, this team also captured the title, but they did it away from the Phoenix Mercury fan base. How much more does it mean to you getting to win it at home?
It's great. I mean, the X Factor, our fans have been phenomenal. You guys are great. And, you know, what a lesson to all of us. If you want to be the best in whatever you do, the heart, the passion, the soul, the physical conditioning, the teamwork, everything these girls have, they are the best, they are champions.
And now, Coach Gaines, five times in these playoffs, you guys faced elimination. What is it about this team that makes them so special when everything's on the line?
Boy, as people say, you can't teach experience. And I have players who have experience, who've been in this situation before, and they come through every time.
Congratulations. And now for the player that helped lead the way, the WNBA MVP trophy presentation, and once again, Donna Orender.
Special thanks to our partner Adidas, who showed their support and presented the finals, and now, we all know and love her with 19 points, 7 rebounds, 2.5 assists, and more heart than anybody you'd ever want to beat. The most valuable player of the 2009 WNBA Finals is none other than Dinah Taurasi.
huge congratulations. You have now won pretty much every major championship. You've won Olympic gold. You've won a national championship. You've won two WNBA titles. But tonight marks the first time you've ever done it on your home floor. How much did these guys help you?
You know, winning never gets old, but when you do it with a group, never gets old. But when you do it with a group that generally cares about each other and you don't care about any of the individual stuff, our whole goal coming into training camp into this summer was to redeem ourselves as individuals, as basketball players, as teammates, as coaches, as GMs, and I think as a group, we put it together. Where'd it go? No, I don't want that one. Where's the big one? And the big one is what we wanted. So, you know what? Yeah, this is what it's all about.
Absolutely. Now, about after game three, you told me, Diana, that you guys were going to have to earn it. And boy, did you. It took five games down to the last seconds of this fifth and final game. Ultimately, how did you guys keep your composure and grab that big trophy?
Well, being down 2-1 to a great team with great players, it's not easy. And we had to go and take it. Coach Gaines put on the board today, take it. And that's what we had to do. Get it by the neck and take it. That's what we did.
And that you did. Congratulations. Ladies and gentlemen, your 2009 WNBA champions.
So Diana Taurasi named MVP, but you got to give a nod to Cappy Pondexter, who had 24 points tonight and kind of carried them through the series as well.
Well, she was a big spark early in the first half, and those two feed off each other. That's Batman and Robin together, and that means championships.
Don't see it changing anytime soon either. I mean, this is going to be a franchise, not just a team, that you're going to have to deal with for years to come in the WNBA. The Mercury win it here in Game 5, 94-86. Coming up next, SportsCenter. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Carolyn Peck, Heather Cox, Rebecca Lobar, our entire crew, I'm Terry Gannon. It has been a memorable series from Game 1 to Game 5.
This is the WNBA Finals.
How about catching?
She's something special. And Diana Taurasi is still cut loose.
How do you like that play?
Pondexter got it.
January. How do you get the crowd going here? They're on their feet here in Phoenix. Under 10 seconds left. Douglas knocks down a three. We go to overtime. Under a minute. Hoffman, believe, back to Indiana. Smith lets it go. Game over. Indiana wins game three. Game four was the heartbreaker for Indy in Indianapolis. A chance to close it out. It was Phoenix sending it back here to the desert for game five. The decisive game five. Too much Taurasi, too much Pondexter, too much Taylor. And once again, for the second time in 3 years, the Phoenix Mercury are the champs of the WNBA.